Obedient, you know, and last night the pastor asked us to wear red, and I thought there would nobody be here who would be redder than I. But I totally underestimated the women of Lilliput. However, we are privileged to be here. You know, the Seventh-day Adventist Church is serious about health. Ever since the fall of man in the Garden of Eden, man has been degenerating, both physically and spiritually. But it is God's desire that we should prosper and be in health, both physically and spiritually. The Seventh-day Adventist Church, we operate one of the most advanced, and we have so many. We don't even talk about hospitals anymore. We talk about health systems. In the United States, I'll just take one state, the state of Florida. Just one health system, we operate 21 hospitals. And that's just one state. In the Inter-American Division, we have 13, we operate 13 hospitals. And right here in Kingston, Jamaica, we operate a hospital. Who knows the name of it? Andrews Memorial Hospital. And I tell you, it is making waves in Kingston. So much so that when the United States Embassy decided on a hospital to examine persons who are planning to migrate to the United States, guess which one they chose? Andrews. Tonight we are privileged to have once again Sister Nancy Wilson, the wife of the evangelist, and she has been blessing our hearts with health lectures. And she is serious about health. She's a physiotherapist by profession, and she knows all about health. And tonight, again, help me welcome to the podium Sister Nancy Wilson as she brings us the health lecture for tonight.
Thank you, and I have to say the reason I don't have red on is because I didn't know what the pastor was going to say last night when I was packing my suitcase a week ago. So had I known, I would have put some red in my suitcase so I could have worn it tonight. Anyway, tonight we're going to be talking about the liquid of life. We will explore the importance of water on the inside of our bodies. Our planet, as we know, is mostly water. When you look at a satellite photo of Earth taken from space, you can see an astonishing 71% of our planet is water. It's ocean water, salt water. And while this water is filled with a huge variety of creatures that thrive in salt water, for we humans to drink that water is basically death. In fact, of all the water on the earth, get this, only 0.37%, 37% of the water on this earth is in its natural state safe to drink. Just pretend in your mind you have 100 Jamaican dollars. If you take one of those 100 dollar bills and you cut it into three pieces, and then you have 99 full dollar bills, Jamaican dollars, you would have approximately only one-third of that $1 bill, which would represent drinkable water on this earth. Water is a precious commodity, especially when we realize that all of life on Earth, including humans, is dependent upon water. Water is as basic to our existence as is the air we breathe. Without water, our heart, our liver, our kidneys, every organ of our body would stop functioning and we would die. We have literally trillions of cells in our body, and every one of those cells needs water to survive. Next to water, air is the most water is the most vital element needed for our survival. By weight, when a newborn is born, it is approximately 75% water. When we become adults, we are about 70% water. A man weighing 90 kilograms or kilos has about 62 kilos, is that right, of water in his body. So we're mostly water. The gray matter in our brain is 85% water. Blood is about 83% water. Muscles are almost 75% water. And even bones, you know, you've seen bones and they look like they're just hard and there's no moisture in them. Bones are 20 to 25% water. The cells and tissues of the body not only contain water, but are also continually bathed in fluid. Water is the liquid of life. It performs so many functions in our body that are essential for our existence and our well-being. Water forms the transport system within our body. It's the lubricant for movement. If we had no water in our joints, we would have a very difficult time moving, and also in the muscles. Water is the prime transporter for waste by way of the kidneys. Water helps keep our temperature, our body temperature, regulated at the right temperature. If you don't have enough water in your body, then your body will overheat. Now, we lose water through evaporative cooling. If you're too hot, you begin to sweat, and that helps cool you down. About two-thirds of the water that our body requires, we acquire by drinking, by taking it in, ingesting. One-third of the water we get, usually, from the food we eat. Of all the food groups, fruits and vegetables have by far the most water in them. A small percentage of the liquid that we need in our body is actually manufactured through food metabolism. There is more water, like I said, fruits and vegetables have more water than any other food group. There's more water in an apple than in a serving of French fries. It's only one of a dozen you should eat an apple rather than French fries. It's a good reason. It's so much better for you. It's full of nutrients and fiber. So anyway, the body needs to maintain a balance between the water we take in and the amount of water we lose each day. The average human excretes a total of 2.3 liters of water. In prolonged exercise, we can excrete 6.5 liters or lose it through our pores and other ways. The point is, just by the mere act of living, of having our lungs work and breathing in and out and just existing, we use water. We use up water. But whenever we are doing any activity, we're going to need more water. The more active we are, the more water we use. The warmer the temperature, the more water we use. And that water needs to be replaced by the water we drink to make sure that we are drinking enough to hydrate every system of our body, our circulatory system, our muscular system, our skeletal system, our brain. What is the best replacement for all of this water use? Anyone want to guess? Water, just plain water. It's not coffee, it's not tea, it's not soft drinks, and do you know what? It's not even fruit juice. Water is the best. When we don't provide the body with enough water, it attempts to avoid dehydration by decreasing sweat and urine output. If this attempt by the body fails to compensate for the loss and insufficient fluid intake persists, if you're not drinking, we can become dehydrated, which is actually very dangerous. Dehydration causes an impairment of the body's cooling mechanisms. Like I said, we can become overheated and we can have insufficient disposal of body wastes. The blood thickens and blood flow becomes impaired. And do you know that when you are dehydrated and you are not drinking what you should be, you are at a greater risk for heart attacks and strokes? Because as your blood thickens, it increases the intravascular clotting of your blood. So that alone is a fantastic reason to make sure you get enough water. Dehydration may also cause a person to have a dizzy spell or have a terrible headache. And it can also result in mild or extreme fatigue. And it can also result in confusion, especially as we get older. Dehydration may occur. So if you're going for a really long hike or a fast walk or a jog, you need to make sure you're hydrated before you even begin, but then you drink periodically through that exercise time and afterwards as well. You want to be very careful not to become dehydrated under these circumstances. Drinking inadequate water also predisposes you not only to kidney stones, but to gallstones. And if any of you have ever had a kidney stone, they say it's really, really painful. So you can help avoid that by drinking enough water. Water is crucial to our entire digestive system. Lack of adequate water is actually one of the most common causes of constipation. Exercise and fiber in our diet also play an important role in this as well to prevent constipation. It's estimated that adequate hydration in older people could save literally thousands of days of hospitalization and millions of dollars each year. That is how important taking enough water each day, that's how important it is that we need to get adequate water. In other words, many medical problems could be avoided if we keep our body hydrated. And it doesn't cost anything, does it? It's free. You don't have to go to the pharmacy to get it. You can just turn on your tap and get this pure water. Experts today recommend that to stay hydrated during prolonged physical activity, we drink before, during, and after that activity. It's important, too, in the morning when you get up, your body is dehydrated after sleeping all night. One of the first things you should do in the morning is drink at least one or two tall glasses of pure water. And then at regular intervals throughout the day. We perspire, you know, when we sleep, and that's one way we lose water at night. Begin drinking water in the morning. Getting ahead of myself here. How much water should we drink every day? Do you think it's the same amount for everyone? No. It all depends on what we're doing, doesn't it? If you're sitting in a nice, cool house and you're just sitting there reading a book, you don't need as much water as if you're out gardening in the heat. And you know what? Men require more water than women do because they tend to be larger and they need more water. So for each one of us, it's going to be different. We need to consider our level of activity. But in general, men need to drink about 3 liters or 13 cups of water every day. This might sound like a lot, but if you start early in the morning and you just drink a glass every, you know, couple hours, by the end of the day, you can have that down without even thinking about it. For women, it's about 2.2 liters or 8 or 9 cups a day, or glasses. Whatever amount you drink, make sure the water is pure. Contaminated water can be very, very dangerous. If you have pure water, be thankful to the Lord for it, because many on this planet don't have that privilege. Many have to walk for hours to get a bucket of water. So thank God that you can turn that faucet on, have pure water come into that glass. I want to ask you tomorrow, first thing in the morning, go for that glass of water. And I want to challenge you tomorrow, try to drink a little bit more than you're used to drinking. And when you find it difficult, think of all the health benefits for our mind, our heart. You want to stay as healthy as you can and do all the preventative medicine that you can. So I'm going to be asking you tomorrow night how you did with your water drinking. Okay?
Amen. Amen. Well, look at my nearest red, and you'll agree that I'm not so colorblind. Speaking of water, God gives water that comes not from the well. And we have come to that critical point in tonight's service where we will hear the "Thus saith the Lord." I am privileged to again present to you the man of God. Are you ready? The answer is yes. Are you ready?
Yes.
We pray the Lord for his son, one who is competent by way of submission to the Holy Spirit, one who is Christ-like, one who is commissioned by the power of the Lord to rightly divide the word of truth. I consider the prayer of William Beatrice, "Oh, for a flame of living fire that shines so bright in saints of old, which bade them to heaven aspire, calm in distress, in danger bold." Let us allow the Lord to pour out his Holy Spirit upon us as we receive the word of God. And let us pray a prayer for our president, Pastor Ted Wilson. Here in Jamaica, land we love, there is a divine pulsation. Before he comes to us, we will hear the wonderful voice and powerful message coming to us from none other than our singer, Raquel Merchant.
Even when we are not faithful, God continues to be faithful to us. Amen? When we continue to mess up, pray over and over again, he remains faithful. He keeps us alive, and he continues to give us life. Amen? He is more faithful than we could ever be, right? So I pray that this song will bless your hearts tonight as you consider how much God has been faithful to you.
Still, my God, he was faithful.
see once again. He's been faithful, faithful to me. Looking back, his love and mercy
Good evening.
Good evening.
If God has been faithful to you today, say amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Sister Raquel, for that beautiful, beautiful song. God is faithful to each of us. You can never, ever doubt that for a moment. And thank you also for the beautiful song, Amazing Grace. That thrilled my heart to hear that beautiful song. Well, thank you, Nancy, for the lecture on water. And I brought my water. I started drinking a little bit of it while she was actually giving her lecture. You know, water is really important for us. Water is also important for a wonderful spiritual experience as well. In fact, on Saturday, on Sabbath, at the big convention center, there will be an exciting ceremony that will use water. And that is baptism. And I know that some of you have been preparing for baptism, and it is going to be a wonderful experience for all of us to enjoy that beautiful baptism. Now tonight, again, as we've done each evening, we'll give you an opportunity, those of you who have come, to respond to the call of God to your heart and to ask you to make that decision for baptism. Now, we've been praying for mothers and fathers and young people and children. Tonight, we're going to pray for grandparents. You know, the family unit is a marvelous and wonderful unit that God has created. And what a beautiful thing it is to have children and parents and grandparents. Now, I may look a little bit older. I think my wife looks rather young. But do you know how many grandchildren we have? 10. We praise God for 10 lovely grandchildren. So I'm going to be standing, and Nancy's going to be standing, and there are a number of you who will stand. I would like to ask all grandparents to just stand and we will pray for you. Beautiful, beautiful. All right. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for creating us and creating us into families. We know that Adam and Eve began this great cavalcade of children over these past 6,000 plus years. And Lord, many of us are so grateful to be grandparents and be able to relate to these precious grandchildren. But the most important thing is, Lord, as we think back over the many centuries, there have been many people, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and on from Adam and Eve, who have not known you. And so today, Lord, this evening, we ask that you will help all of us as grandparents and as parents to help our children and grandchildren know you in a most marvelous way and accept you as their Savior. We want to be united as families in heaven. Now, Lord, in a special way, bless all these grandparents, grandfathers, and grandmothers as they stand and commit themselves to you tonight. Thank you for hearing us. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Well, this evening we are going to be reviewing a marvelous, marvelous antidote, a cure for a lot of the challenges and problems that are being faced in this globe and, yes, right here in Jamaica. As I may have mentioned to you, in speaking to government officials from Jamaica, I have picked up that there is a real challenge, and I might tell you this is not in any way limited to Jamaica, but Jamaica has been challenged recently with violence. And that's a real tragedy. It has been a haven of stability, a place people could go to in order to find comfort, assurance, and security. Now, the home used to be safe, but today many homes have changed. Children are exposed to all kinds of versions of what is right and what is wrong. There are competing values for the minds of children. Without a moral compass, our society is thrown into a great state of confusion. So society says, you know, your own mind is the standard. Whatever you think is right, go ahead and do it. As long as you don't hurt someone, as long as it feels good, as long as you think it's right, nobody can tell you what to do. But I want to tell you, the Bible tells us something different. That's why we've chosen, or that's why the theme of our meetings is, let's repeat that together, if it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it disagrees with the Bible, it's not for me. Now, how do you protect moral values in an immoral world? How can you protect your mind from those influences around you that seem to bombard you all the time? How do you protect your children and grandparents? We have prayed for you tonight. How do you protect your grandchildren? How can you be moral in an immoral world? Now, our Bibles have a message for the last generation of men and women who are living on the planet Earth. I don't know about you, but I would love to be part of the last generation before Jesus returned so that I can look up and see him coming in the clouds of heaven. Well, if I pass away and die, are touched with the thought that your brother has died. And we know that is a very difficult situation. And one day, if some of us do die, but we die in the Lord, we will still see Jesus. Can you say amen?
Amen.
When he comes, because he will wake us up from the grave, and we will be alive to see him coming, because the trumpet will sound.
Amen.
What a wonderful truth that is. So everyone who is dead is just basically sleeping. Well, of course, they're dead. Jesus said, you know, it's like you're sleeping, and people kind of questioned him. Then he just said, you know, it's death. Now, I really like what Pastor Samuel said. I'm going to try and remember that. In fact, at our meeting that we're going to have on Sunday, I'm going to try and remember and tell them, because Pastor Samuel's, I don't know if you've picked it up, he said, I am not going to die until I'm dead. Which means as long as you've got life, keep living. Enjoy it. That's why you need to drink some water. Anyway, now the message is for you and for me in the Bible. And it's calling us to be moral people. It's calling us to morality. It's calling us back to the great standard that God has set himself. And in fact, it is a message for a dying world. Here is the message. Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. Now that's from Revelation 14, verse 7, part of what we call the three angels' messages. Now this passage in Revelation answers the question of moral responsibility. Why is there so much crime and violence in society? So much immorality? Why is there so much lawlessness? Now today, about noon, I had the great privilege to attend a special meeting called by Pastor Samuels and his team of the West Jamaica Conference, where we honored those who are leaders in our community, those who are part of law enforcement, those who are business individuals in the Chamber of Commerce, those who are attorneys, those who are even the head of the airport came to our meeting today, because we need those kinds of stable authorities in our life. And those people are fighting lawlessness. You see, this involves the issue of responsibility in a moral sense. So judgment calls us to accountability for our actions. Now, if you're not responsible for what you do, how can God's judgment hold you accountable for those actions? People say, well, if I have no responsibility, if I'm an alcoholic, it's just because my father was an alcoholic and my grandfather was an alcoholic, so I'm not responsible. Many excuse themselves and they say, well, I take drugs, I'm a drug addict because I was abused as a child, so I'm not responsible. And if a criminal in a prison, the society we live in is a society that largely says, you are not responsible for your actions. Now, it also declares that right and wrong is something that everyone can determine in their own mind. Now, the idea is, I am only responsible to myself. Since I am a human being, I am going to take my own course, and I'm going to determine what is right or wrong. I am not responsible to a higher power like God. But when you take that position, that you are not responsible to a higher power, and that there is no judgment, then you have no certain moral standards to guide you. Judgment implies responsibility and moral choices. Now, in these last days of Earth's history, and I believe that Jesus is coming very soon, God is calling you, the men and women, the boys and girls, the young people of Jamaica, to judgment. All of us will face judgment. So does God have a standard by which he is going to judge us in the final judgment? Yes, he does. God's law is the basis of morality and the standard of judgment. So the Bible speaks to a society that says, my mind is the highest authority and standard. There is no judgment. But the Bible says you are responsible for your actions, for the hour of his judgment has come, as Revelation 14, verse 7 told us. The Bible calls us back to the law of God and to God's standard by which we will be judged and the standard by which we ought to live. Now, the Apostle James, the brother of Jesus, puts it this way. James chapter 2, verse 12. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. The entire law of God. Now, I want you to understand the laws of God are not restrictions. They are not straight jackets that you have to fit into and that you do not have liberty. Even though it says, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. And some young people say, oh, that's not for me. I want to be free. Let me tell you, by following God's precious commandments, you will be the freest person on this planet. Now, here are a few examples. Okay, the sixth commandment. Exodus 20, verse 13. Simple one. Profound one. Thou shalt not kill. That preserves the sanctity of life. The seventh commandment, the 14th verse, thou shalt not commit adultery. You see, that preserves the institution of the family. We just prayed for grandparents tonight. We prayed for mothers and fathers, for children. The family unit is protected by this beautiful commandment. The eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal, in verse 15. It protects our possessions and our properties. You know, some people in a safer age would leave their doors unlocked, leave the keys of the car in the ignition. I want to tell you, you have to think two or three times before doing that today. Think of the chaos in society if the principles of God's law are openly disregarded. That's what happens when the standard is not kept by people. Now, Revelation 11, verse 19, then the temple of God was opened in heaven, and the ark of his covenant was seen in his temple. Now, what's the ark of the covenant? Well, inside the sanctuary that God instructed Moses to build in the desert, and then certainly in Jerusalem, the Ark of the Covenant contained the law of God. The stone with God's instructions. God's law was placed in that Ark of the Covenant as the basis of all morality. Now, the Ark of God's covenant contains his law. God's law is the foundation of his very throne. God is calling us to keep his law. Now, judgment and law are part of the gospel. Don't tell me, oh, we don't have to worry about the law anymore. It was nailed to the cross. Just love everybody. Do anything you want. God's going to forgive you. The law is not important. I want to tell you, judgment and law are part of the gospel, not apart from the gospel. Well, when Christ was crucified on the cross, he was judged as a sinner dying to pardon our sins. We studied that last night. The marvelous gift of eternal life and salvation through the sinless life of Christ on behalf of you and me. Judgment is part of the gospel. Now, if God could have changed his law, Jesus would not have had to die. But the Bible says, and you know this text very well, the wages of sin is death. So if God's law was changed, why would God have to die if it was not changed? Because we broke God's law. Now, in 1 John chapter 3, verse 4, whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. Now, you may not think it's a sin to steal something. Sin is more than what you think in your own mind. Here's the Bible's definition of sin. Sin is breaking God's law. A man says, well, look, I'm not so satisfied with my marriage, so if I go out for a week with someone else, that's okay. The Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery. God's law is eternal, a moral standard which defines sin and establishes our accountability to God himself. His law defines what morality is, even if your mind does not. You cannot trust your own mind. The Bible says sin is breaking God's law, and the hour of God's judgment is come. Now, the Bible says you are responsible for your actions. Of God's throne is God's law. And what our children need today, and what our grandchildren need today, and what we all need today is not a diet of constant observation on television or smartphones or in books or on the screen of murder, violence, and immorality. Our children need to be taught moral principles of God in order to live pure, happy lives. Now, the moral law of God protects us. God's law is not just some regulation to restrict our happiness. God's law is the genuine way to happiness. God's law protects us from a lifestyle that could very easily destroy us. In fact, it is destroying many people even today. Well, some people say, some Christians have said, well, we don't preach about the law in our church. We preach about God's love, as if they were two different things. Love always leads to obedience. Love doesn't lead you to disobey. It leads you to keep God's commandments. What did Jesus say in John chapter 14 and verse 15? If you love me, keep my commandments. Now, Jesus didn't say, well, you know, if you really love me, you don't have to keep my commandments. No, love's response is to keep God's commandments. So the reason that we obey is not because we're trying to earn favor with God. We've talked about that. You cannot do enough good things in order to chalk up enough good points in heaven, and God finally says, I think you've done pretty well. Come on, we'll let you join heaven. No, that's not the way it works. We do good things because we are connected with the source of all good things, Jesus Christ, and he helps us to keep the commandments through his power. Amen. So, it's our response of love to him. I obey God not in order to be saved, but because I am saved. Christ won salvation for all of us on the cross. But when I come to the cross, when you come to the cross, your obedience is an evidence that you are saved, that you are connected to the source of all power. In 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, now by this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. So John says there is an evidence that we actually know God, and it is that we keep his commandments. It tells everyone and ourselves that we are born again in Christ, and he is controlling us through his Holy Spirit. What a wonderful piece of evidence that we are truly Christ's. Now, he who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. I mean, how much plainer could Scripture be? Now, when we're committed to Christ, when we genuinely know him, when our hearts are surrendered to him, the natural response is to obey him. Now, if anyone says to you, well, you know, God's law is done away with, forget about those commandments, you know, don't worry about all of that, we just believe in God's love and everything is covered, don't believe about the law at all because it's just not important. I want to tell you, my dear friends here in Lilliput, grace and law are not contradictory ideas. When you are saved by grace, you are not saved to disobey. You are saved to obey. So what is the role of God's precious law? First of all, salvation is by grace. We've talked about that. Old Testament believers looked forward to a Christ who would come. And in the New Testament, we look to a Christ who has come. They were saved by grace, and we are saved by grace. But if it's all about grace, what's the role of God's law? What's the purpose of the law? Well, let's look at Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Paul is telling us in the epistle to the Romans that by the law is the knowledge of sin. So if you do away with the law, there is no sin. Now, if there's no law, there's no sin, it's by the law that sin is revealed. And God reveals this to us in a very powerful way. Paul says in Romans 7:7, I would not have known sin except through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, you shall not covet. So if you break God's law, it is sin. So the role of the law is to define sin. And the law says this is right and this is wrong. And the law defines the moral standard of God's great judgment. The law defines the foundation of really all society. Now the judgment in Revelation calls men and women everywhere back to keeping the law. It calls Christians who are saved by grace to live happy, holy, obedient, righteous lives. Revelation's judgment does not justify our own sinful behavior. It calls us to moral responsibility. So let's ask the question, what is the role of grace? Ephesians 2, chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, beautiful text. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So grace is God's mercy. It is his pardon. It is God's forgiveness. It is His power. And most of all, it is God's love reaching out to you and to me. Now, does grace do away with God's law? If you're saved by grace, does that mean that you can go ahead and break God's law and it really doesn't matter? Well, let's look at Romans 3, 31. Do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. So Paul is trying to tell us, don't think we do away with the law by faith through grace. We actually establish it. We keep it. People who are saved by grace are obedient people. Matthew, the first book in the New Testament, chapter 5, that great chapter, the Sermon on the Mount. If you're not familiar with Matthew 5, get acquainted. It is a marvelous explanation by Jesus himself of how we ought to live. Verse 17, do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. So Jesus didn't come to do away with the law. He was the living law. When people saw Jesus preaching and teaching and healing, they were looking not at the written word, they were looking at the living word. He is the embodiment of God's law itself. Christ fulfilled the law. Romans 6, verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Now, when does sin have dominion or power or control over you? It's when you follow your own way rather than God's way. When you just kind of, in a very casual way, go out and break God's law, then sin chains you, because the Bible says sin is the transgression of the law. Now, what does it mean to be under the law? It means to be under the law as a method of salvation. It means to be under the condemnation of the law because we broke it. It means I trust the law to save me and I don't keep it. So I'm condemned. So what is sin? Sin is the breaking of God's law. I'm condemned by the law I broke, so I'm under the law. Well, what does it mean to be under grace? To be under grace, you come to the cross. You kneel at the foot of the cross. To be under grace means that you accept Christ's pardon, receive Christ's forgiveness, and then you are filled with His power. Christ writes in your very heart His own law, and then you desire to obey Him. This is the supernatural experience of being converted. Who can explain a thief who becomes the most generous benefactor on the planet? Who can explain someone who is a drunkard who becomes, and we throw ourselves at his feet? He says, my child, no matter what you have done in the past, no matter how sinful your life may have been, my child, I will forgive you. You can begin again. I want to tell you, brothers and sisters here in Lilliput, that can happen every day. For we are sinners. You're not saved once and then you simply declare yourself to be perfect. Every day you need to fall at the foot of the cross and accept righteousness from Jesus every day, because the law reveals our need. When you look at the law, you see really who you are. You don't measure up to that law. And when you come to Jesus, when you look at his law, you see that at times you've been impatient. You maybe haven't been as kind as you should have been. You come to the Lord and you fall at his feet and you ask for forgiveness and for a new life that moment in Jesus Christ. Now, this is what David meant when he said in Psalm 19, verse 7, "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul." You see, that perfect law drives me to Jesus, and I say, "Oh, Lord, Savior, my heart is broken. My heart is crushed because of my sin. Please forgive me. Lead me, Lord, to keep your law. Lead me to be obedient." Somebody came to Jesus trying to trick him. In fact, in the Bible, you will find several instances of where people tried to somehow deceive and trip Jesus. A lawyer came and he asked the question, and this is found in Matthew 22. "Teacher, which is them? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Now, what was Jesus doing when he was responding in this way? He was summarizing the wonderful Ten Commandments. Because Jesus said, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. So the entire law can be summarized in one word, and that is love. Love God, vertical, love your fellow man or human beings, that's horizontal. Jesus summarized the first four of the Ten Commandments with love to God, and then the last six with love to our fellow human beings. And Jesus was saying, if you love fully, you will love God. If you love fully, you will love your fellow human beings. Love always leads to obedience. So you see, keeping God's law doesn't put you in bondage. It actually takes you out of bondage. The Ten Commandments were not given to restrict our freedom, but they were given so we could truly be free. They were given by God himself. So listen how they are actually introduced. And in that famous chapter of Exodus, chapter 20, let's look at verse 2. "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." You see, it's the Lord God, the Lord of heaven and earth, who wrote those commandments with his own finger in the stone as moral principles for all time. So let's look at those magnificent commandments. Exodus 20, verses 3 to 17. "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." So God is saying in the first commandment, I want to be number one in your life. "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image." God says, don't come to me through images. Come to me directly. "Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain." Love God enough to respect his name. Don't use his name so flippantly, so commonly, that you show disrespect for God, who is your creator and redeemer. Now think of it. The name of Jesus, at that name, angels in heaven veil their faces. At that name, angels sing, "Holy, holy, holy." And people use that name in cursing someone? The fourth commandment, beautiful commandment. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Now, my dear friends, you will not want to miss tomorrow night's lecture, because we're going to talk more about the Sabbath, about rest, about what does this mean to remember the Sabbath, and which day is the Sabbath? Is it the first day? Is it the seventh day? Well, we're going to look at it very, very carefully. And in fact, Nancy is going to talk about a parallel subject of health in rest, physical rest. And we will explore spiritual rest. So worship the Creator of heaven and earth, and worship Him who made you. All right, the fifth commandment, honor thy father and thy mother. We live in an age when children no longer obey their parents, and kids say to their parents, you can't tell me what to do. I want to tell you, especially young people here, remember that honoring your father and your mother is a wonderful commandment that has a promise that your life may be long on this earth if you honor your father and your mother. Well, the next commandment says, thou shalt not kill. And, of course, that's very plain. Thou shalt not commit adultery at a time when there's so much immorality in the world and lack of moral purity. God sets a beautiful standard for true love and commitment. Then another one, thou shalt not steal. I want to tell you, it is still wrong to steal. It is still wrong to shoplift. It's still wrong to take something that doesn't belong to you. The next commandment, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Lying is still wrong. Gossip is wrong. Dragging somebody's good name through the dust is wrong. The next commandment, thou shalt not covet. Now, the Ten Commandments speaks to this generation about God's commandments to you and to me. The Ten Commandment law speaks with relevance. The psalmist revealed that commands are forever. In Psalm 111, verses 7 to 9, the works of his hands are verity and justice. All his precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever. He has commanded his covenant forever. Now, Satan lost heaven because of disobedience. Adam and Eve lost Eden because of disobedience. God is calling his people back to the Ten Commandment law. I will put my laws in their mind and write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Marvelous instruction from Hebrews chapter 8. God says, I'm going to put my law in your mind. Now, what does that mean? Well, if God's law is in our mind, then we're going to know it. If God's law is in our heart, we're going to love his law. God will have a last day people who will have his law written in their hearts and their minds, which means that they love him enough to obey him. Now, let's read a description about God's last day people. By God's grace, I want to be part of that last day people. How about you? Amen. Revelation 14, that same chapter where the three angels are sharing their messages, the very last verse in the third angel's message portion says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So here they are. These are the last day people at the very end of time, before Jesus soon return, faithful ones, and they are keeping God's commandments. and they have the faith of Jesus Christ. So the last chapter in Revelation describes the redeemed in this way. Revelation 22, verse 14, "Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life." So Jesus pardons us. Jesus says, "Come to me, my child." He gives us mercy. And Jesus looks into our eyes and he says, "I have something very, very special I want to do for you. I want to change your life. I want to make you into a new man, into a new woman, into a new young person. I want to ask you, would you like to say tonight, Jesus, come into my life. Jesus, do for me what it is impossible for me to do myself." Amen. A few years ago, a number of years ago, a mother took her young son to see the famed evangelist Dwight Moody. After the sermon, the mother took the little boy and went up to see evangelist Moody. She had one reason for doing that. She wanted her son to shake hands with Dwight Moody. When the boy's turn came to shake the hand of the famous evangelist, he clenched his fist and he would not shake the hand of the evangelist. His mother was completely embarrassed, confused. She urged him, she coaxed him, "Please shake the hand of Dwight Moody." She took the boy's hand and attempted to place it in the preacher's hand, but the boy would not open his fingers. When he finally did, there were a few beautifully colored marbles in his hand. He thought the preacher was going to take all of his marbles. He wouldn't shake the hand because he didn't want to let go of something so inexpensive, so unimportant, but to him it was more important than shaking hands with a true man of God preaching God's word. Tonight, I want to ask you, as we close, how many of you are clinging to something that you need to give up? How many of you are holding on to something that is separating you from God and his precious law of life and love? Is there anything that you are hanging on to that is restricting you from finding your place in God's kingdom? I want to tell you, the Lord's grace and his pardon will take care of your past. The Lord's power will transform your life. His grace will make you a new man and a new woman. God's grace will pardon you and cleanse you from within. God's grace is greater than all of our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed upon all who believe. His grace flows from his throne to your heart right now. And as that beautiful song that Sister Raquel sang tonight, "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." Jesus is reaching out to you tonight. He says, "Follow me. Let me write my law in your heart and your mind. Come to me and find true liberty as you obey me through my power in your life." How many of you tonight would like to say, "Lord, right now and tomorrow and the next day, to fully embrace your love and your pardon in my life and help me to keep your precious Ten Commandments"? If you'd like to say that, would you join me in standing this evening? Amen. Beautiful. What a privilege it is to tell the Lord through our commitment that we want to follow Him in every way. But you know, there may be a young woman, maybe an older lady, older man, maybe a young person. Tonight you've been seeing in a very special way that God's law is not a law of restriction, but it is a law of love and freedom. And perhaps your life has been marred by a lot of misguided direction. And tonight you're saying to the Lord, Lord, I want to make a new start. I want to join the baptismal class. I want to study more about your word. I want to study more about these commandments, about how you can write them in my heart and in my mind. Lord, I want to learn more. I want to be part of God's people. And I'd like to be baptized and join God's remnant people, God's last day people, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Is there someone here tonight who would like to come forward here, and I'll pray with you tonight. I'll pray that the Lord will touch your heart in a marvelous way. Young man, God bless you in a wonderful way. He has a special role for you to play. You are unique in His understanding and mind. He would have come just for you. Praise God for these marvelous decisions. My brother, God is going to use you to be a real missionary. I can tell that. He wants to use you in a powerful way. Sister, God bless you. Thank you for making that decision. As you learn every day what His law is all about, you will see that it is not a law of restriction, but a law of liberty in Christ Jesus. God bless you. Is there another one who would like to come? What a wonderful decision. Sister, praise God for your decision. God be with you in a special way. Thank you for making the most important decision of your life. God will reward you for that as you stay completely in His will. Is there one more? One more who would like to make that public demonstration tonight that this message, the message of Christ, has touched your heart, and you'd like to say, I want to learn more. I want to be part of these wonderful people who understand what serving God and obeying Him is all about. Is there another? Is there one more? What a privilege to have so many of you who are committed to the Lord in a powerful and wonderful way. Praise God for our brother here. Thank you, young man, for making that wonderful decision. Understand that God loves you in a wonderful way, and He's going to use your life to be a testimony and witness for others. Praise be to God. Is there one more before we pray? Remember, tomorrow night we'll give you another opportunity. What a privilege it is to have people come to the foot of the cross. What a privilege for us to do that every day. Is there one more? Well, let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you for this beautiful group of young people. I am just praising you that young people have understood what it means to truly ask you to change their lives and to make them pure, moral, loving, kind, helpful agents for you in society, to help them to be models, testimonies of what you can do in a life. Bless each one of them now as they will be studying and looking forward to baptism, when you will in a public way help them to tell the world, I have died to the old self, and I am coming up a new creature in Jesus Christ. Lord, help us every day to have that precious experience with you. Thank you for hearing us now in this prayer. and bless these young people as they continue to look to you and your law as a way to find true freedom in life. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. God bless each one of you. Please be seated. And I want to remind all of you that tomorrow night we're going to be talking about one of those commandments, the fourth one, the Sabbath. You will not want to miss tomorrow's lecture and focus upon God's Word. May God bless each one of you. Pastor, give us the final word.
Thank you very much, Pastor Wilson. Amen, church.
Amen.
We thank God for using our evangelist, our president, Pastor Ted Wilson, again to declare his word. I want to encourage everyone here tonight. Our president said it early. We need to make sure that we bring a friend tomorrow evening. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? Amen. Bring a friend. Bring someone. When you have found something good, you want others to also have a piece of that. Amen? We have found Jesus, and he is so good to us. We thank God for his mercy. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. We look forward to having you again with us tomorrow evening. May God continue to bless and keep you. And remember, all roads leads to the convention center on Sabbath. Sabbath is going to be a grand time for us, but we are accustomed to acknowledging our online friends. We have a number of individuals who joined us online, and we want to thank so much Rona. We have Manji, we have Basil, we have Marcia, we have Jody, we have Denzel, we have Opal, Donna, Shavardo, Sandre rather. There's Wayne, there's Elaine, there's Enrias, there's Faith, there's Joan and Carlton and John. We thank you guys so much for joining us online. Those who've been on Facebook, those who are on YouTube, thank you so much. And remember also that if you have friends who aren't able to make it any at all, they can join us online. So you can send them the link. We're on West Jamaica Conference's Facebook page. We're also there on YouTube. Feel free to share it on social media so that others can experience the joy that you're experiencing here. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you so much for being here. Enjoy the rest of the evening. Have yourself a good night. God bless you. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow. In times like these, and for those of you our president, he's going to meet and greet, so feel free to meet and greet with him at the door as he meets and greet. Amen? Sister Wilson is also joining him there, so you feel free to meet and greet them as they go. God bless you. Good night.
In times like these, you need a Savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. Be very sure, be very sure. Your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the one.
Love to meet tomorrow evening to practice for funeral and Sunday. So all choir members, you're going to meet tomorrow evening after meeting for funeral and Sunday. And there won't be any family life choir this week, okay?